Welcome to this edition of the Adobe Think Tank from New York City. Follow us on Twitter, hashtag AdobeTT. With me today is Jana Eggers, CEO of Nara Logics, and we're going to talk about artificial intelligence and the future of the enterprise. Welcome, Jana.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here. So, I know you recently had a session on turning enterprises into learning organizations for the purpose of benefiting from AI. Could you talk to us a little bit more about that?
I'm really excited about it. It's a new way of looking at AI as an enabler. And we have not done a great job of turning ourselves into learning organizations, which really means, you know, we've talked about being agile and being able to transform ourselves. That's been in our vernacular for a while. But one of the things we haven't done well is actually do it. And so AI really forces us into that because we're not on a deterministic course anymore. And you've heard that a lot at the conference, that AI is not about determinism, it's about probabilities and options and, you know, context being very important. And I think that's what is going to force us into or enable us into to becoming learning organizations. And there's two key aspects to learning organizations. One is that you have people that are willing and able to engage and learn. And the second side of that is that you have an organization that can change. And so when you look at things like, can't remember the exact numbers, but the S&P 500 average age used to be 60 years and of the companies on the S&P 500, and now it's like 12. And so you see these companies are not staying around for as long. So how do you stay around for a long time? You're more agile and you transform yourself before somebody comes in and transforms the industry that you're in.
So I hear some great learnings here from the learning organization. Being agile, being nimble, being able to move with changes as technology shifts happen. And could you give us some examples of how you'd actually put a learning organization in place? What are some of the steps enterprises could take to do that?
So I think most important is just getting started in an AI project. So I'm not going to tell you to go out and hire PhDs. They're wonderful and great in organizations, but most organizations don't need that level of AI. The tools are really democratized now, and you've seen here at the conference where there's kids in high school building amazing systems, you know, detecting diabetes from retina scans, and a kid in high school did that, not a PhD. So those tools are there. So my encouragement for enterprises is just getting started. So most enterprises have a good technical team, enable them to go out and start doing it, but they have to work with the business people, and they have to work with the people who know the data the best, which may be data scientists, but sometimes that's the business people too. So making sure that all three of those constituents are working together and that you define an AI project, and you can start small and start learning how you learn. But AI isn't about developing one system and keeping it like that. It's about continually regenerating.
And learning as you go.
Right.
So, you know, how do you practically apply AI to solve real business problems? And it's one thing when you do it in the lab, but how do you kind of scale and, like, say, the problem of customer experience? How do you use AI to better enable that?
It's a great question, and I did a workshop at I can't remember which O'Reilly conference, AI conference it was, but a couple back, and one of the things that was interesting is I asked, there were about 150 people there, and I asked the audience, how many of you have active AI projects, and more than a third of the room raised their hand, which surprised me. I thought it would actually be less. And then I said, well, how many of you have something in production? And I had 1.5. And so we're really having a large blocking rate at actually going into production. And so I think that's one of the bigger challenges that we have. And so the reason why I give that as an example is I think the projects haven't shown those real business results that they, so they've been more test and they didn't put the rigor in place to say, what are the business results that I'm expecting to see? And we see that with our customers. That's not unusual for that to happen, that, you know, they come to us and they say, well, we want to start this project in AI because it's important to our organization to do AI, and they don't have any metrics associated with it. I mean, they may say we want to do it in 2 months, but that's not a business metric. And so it's more about what's the business advantage, what value are we going to have to show in order for you, for us, I say, in order for you to license my platform, what value am I going to have to show to you in this project? And it's amazing how many of them have no idea what that answer is. And so we have a process that we go through with them to say, well, what's the problem you're trying to solve? And then we pick one of the problems that has the most business value associated with them.
Very interesting. So you actually help them hone in on the KPIs, the benchmarks, all of the things that they would need to determine if the project's, you know, is really solving a real business problem. Okay. So, you know, you talked a lot about big data also. And so one of the big questions is, as we go into both B2B and B2C workflows, how do you actually turn big data into real insights? And what role can AI play in that?
That's where it gets a little bit hard for people, because people want the answers to be more deterministic. So they want to say, how many people do I have in this category? And the difference with AI is there's a lot of category overlap. So you can say that, but you're not doing it by marketing the segments anymore. You really can go to one-to-one. So everyone is actually a segment of one, which is something we've been trying to get to for years.
Right.
But the problem with that is that's not how our systems are set up.
True.
And I think Starbucks has a great example of that. They, in a year alone, went from, if I'm remembering the numbers right, something like it took them 2 weeks to get an email out. They only had 30 groups. And so everybody went into one of 30 groups. Within a year, they were actually delivering individual messages to, you know, something like 14 million people. Completely tailored to them, and they could do it in real time. So if you bought something that morning at Starbucks, your email that afternoon could actually be responsive to what that was, if it made sense. And so you can do things like that. You just have to, again, you have to get started. And they didn't go from, you know, 2 weeks to real time in one jump. They actually did go through a phase where they went from, I think it was 2 weeks to a few days, and then made the leap to real time. So that's I think that's a good thing to do, is get started, push yourself, but then don't say, well, it took a long time to get from 2 weeks to 3 days, so we're going to take, you know, even longer to go from 3 days to real time. Say, no, I just learned that. Now 3 days needs to happen in a week.
Perfect. So I hear some great advice for enterprises and brands there on how to actually implement this. Any other tips that you have for implementing AI strategies like that?
Yeah, I would say get started. And that's the problem. You know, people tell me they don't have enough data. There is plenty of data in your organization. You have enough data to get started. They tell me they don't have the experts. You really don't need the experts. There's so much training that's online. There's so much available that you can learn from. So don't let that get, you know, let that stop you. What you should stop at is, if this is just a research project in AI, don't do that. Really, again, make sure that you're working on something that's business value, and make sure that you're willing to learn from what that is. And there isn't, you know, you don't have to be a Facebook or a Google or an Amazon to do this. There's plenty. I brought up Starbucks, brick and mortar company. We work with Procter & Gamble. They're a 180-year-old company. There's a startup that actually took some of the work that Microsoft did and improved it. So, you know, they're improving on something that Microsoft did. So there's examples everywhere of amazing companies that have no experience in AI that are really pushing AI forward.
So a learning mindset, an agile mindset, and you can actually implement the latest and greatest.
Exactly.
Technology coming out. That's fantastic. Well, thank you very much for being with us in the set.
Thank you for hosting us.
And we're wrapping up this episode of the Adobe Think Tank. And do follow us. hashtag Adobe Think Tank or adobethinktank.com, where you'll find lots of great content on artificial intelligence and the future of the enterprise. Thanks again, Jana.
Thank you.